respected director of this esteemed institute, Professor Jain, Professor Srivastava, other faculties and friends. First of all, a little sorry for being this quite late as compared to the scheduled time, but thanks to Banaras traffic, I could have some taste of how you must be commuting every day. I took more time on the roads of Banaras than I flight from Delhi to Banaras. So well, as my introduction has been elaborated, I have been working in the area of innovation for last 20 years or so, not so much in last 5 years because of my other activities, but I still keep a deep interest in the innovation ecosystem in India. And more I came out of corporate work and started interacting with many people, both in academia, industry, policy makers and students at various level, I actually had a better understanding, because when you are in corporate, your work is very streamlined, a lot of things are taken for granted. Most of the time money is also not an issue. Regulatory issues we can deal with at a very professional level. And the policy generally doesn't affect the corporate environment unless there is a major policy change. So in last 5 years, when I interacted with many students like you in ISERS, also visited several institutes across India and globe, some of the observations I would like to share with you. First of all, even though we have said that it is opportunity and challenges, let me start with the challenges first. And according to me, the biggest challenge of innovation in India is our education system. Because since we join the formal education, maybe at the class of one, first standard, we have been asked to mug something and throw it at the time of examination. How much you have understood it, how much you have grasped it conceptually, that's not a business of any examiner or our examination system. Even though there are some changes now in last recent past, but by and large the system remains same. And therefore, most of the students, I'm not saying all of them, they have a very good information, they have some knowledge, but they have very little insight of any basic concept. Now, I'm sure you are all here at some stage of your education, you must have learned biology, or at least a basic biology. So when I was in corporate, I used to go in Ahmedabad, I used to go to a very famous and as old institute as this, Maharaja Sayajirao University in Baroda, as an examiner of a master's student in microbiology. The microbiology department in MSU was the first microbiology department set up in India, or first or second maybe. So it is so old and a very established one. So the MSc students, final students, I used to ask one very simple question. And that question used to be that in 3 test tubes, you have been given 3 aqueous solutions. One contains DNA, other contains RNA, and third contains protein. Design a simple experiment to identify which is what. So 50% of the students who are otherwise very bright, you ask them the latest concept of tissue engineering or gene therapy, they will tell you like they are the expert in that field. 50% student couldn't design an experiment of this level. Another 25% would somehow answer, and only 25% would actually design a simple experiment to characterize these 3. Now, we learn so much about DNA, RNA, protein, but we don't know how to identify them quickly. So this example will tell you what is the real crux of lack of innovation in our students' ecosystem. Because we are never tuned for a problem solving. We have been always tuned to reply religiously, almost like a religious scripture. If you have, I am very religious person, so no offense against religion. So if you know Bhagavad Gita's 18th chapter, and someone asks you what is 5th shloka of 18th chapter, you will tell it as it is written by Maharshi Vedvyasa. So we are good, very good at it. But if we ask what's its meaning, then very few would be knowing. If you ask that, okay, you tell me one shloka of Bhagavad Gita which you have tried to implement in your life, there will be still very few. Same thing applies in the innovation sector also. So my first request all of you, especially to the young student, is challenge everything you know. Challenge your teachers. He may be the Nobel laureate, but don't take anything verbatim. Ask them pertinent questions till you understood the concept very well. Once you understood the concept very well, then you can forget the details, or you can keep the memorized detail only for the exam sake. So I feel that this is the first challenge for innovation. Second challenge is that we are too streamlined in our education system. I was very glad to hear that there are so many interdisciplinary departments working here. But most of the time, in the 11th, 12th, only we make a choice nowadays that if you want to have biology, you give up mathematics. If you want to have mathematics, give up biology. And then we continue that stream far ahead. I myself was a victim of it. I ignored chemistry to some extent, organic chemistry especially. And then later on, when I was doing drug discovery, I found that it is a major impediment in my professional career. So, and today's science is interdisciplinary. Today's science is no more, it doesn't work in isolation. So having interdisciplinary approach is must for innovation. And that is also one of the lacuna in our education system. Third and most important is that I always ask this question myself, that why Indians are very good in cricket or in chess, but not so good in football or basketball. To this question, my answer is very simple. You may agree to it or you may not agree. My answer is that in chess is an individual game. In cricket, one batsman or one bowler can have extraordinary performance and he can win, and rest of the 10, even though they are out on zero or they no bowler took a wicket, still the team can win. So performance of individual can make a victory, but that is not possible in basketball or football. Everyone has to consistently perform. Even if someone performs less than its best, even for a minute, you will lose a game in basketball or football. In short, we are very poor team player. We are excellent people as far as we are alone. As long as we are left to ourselves and do something, we will do marvels. But if you ask to collaborate with each other, then we will first start asking, okay, if I collaborate with him, whether he will get first authorship or I will get first authorship. Who will get bigger grant? Who will get award? Even before the project is conceptualized. And I have worked abroad almost for 5 years, and then I consistently interacted with the best academic and industrial labs overseas. And I find that the researcher in next lab, he will just walk in over a cup of coffee, discuss some idea, and they both of them, they start working over it. And if it succeeds, they both publish it. If it doesn't succeed, they throw it out without blaming. Most of the collaborations in Western world doesn't start before paperwork. They start before actually signing something. They just start over a cup of coffee or in the nightclub somewhere, or a glass of beer. So we lack this capability to interact with something which will complement to our work. So these are the three major lacunas in our education system. Then if we go to the higher level, there is, of course, there are issues with our regulatory system, which government has tried to do it, and I will come to it little late. And later on, there is also a challenge at a funding level. We have yet to have a very good ecosystem where the big challenges, where the problem which we are trying to address is very difficult, and chances of failure are more than chances of success. The funding mechanism is not there, or it is very inadequate. Because our funders also are not risk takers. And the classic Western world concept of venture funding or venture capitalism is at a very nascent state in India. Though there are some funding mechanisms available now, thanks to the government initiatives, but they are highly inadequate. So any innovation to grow from the idea to actually creating a prototype and then testing it in a field and then bringing it to the market, there are multiple challenges in Indian ecosystem at every level. And we must understand, I am not trying to disappoint you, but we must understand that this is the system which is prevalent in India. Some of them we ourselves can overcome. For example, we are always very passionate about what we work, and we continue to work even if we know that it's not going to work, because we are extremely fearful of the failure. When I was in corporate, a fresh PhD, when I used to interview, one of my favorite questions was this, that okay, you have done this PhD work, fantastic, you published 5 papers, for last 5 years you are working. Now I want to ask you one thing, that if funding is not an issue, you will get unlimited funding, how you will continue your PhD work and take it to the next level? Most of the students used to fail to give a very bright answer. They would give some answer, but if the funding is not a problem, then you should go from level 1 to level 10, because most of the time funding is a problem. I am saying the funding is not a problem. Here the lack of ideas is a problem. And there is also, they have such a tremendous fear of failure that if I suggest something big and if I fail, then my parents will blame me, my spouse will blame me, my boss will definitely blame me. On the contrary, in the biggest innovation centers or hubs like Silicon Valley, if you have initiated a startup and you failed a couple of times, actually it is taken as a reward, or actually it is taken as a plus point when you start a third startup. Because the VC funders, they think that, okay, he has learned his mistakes, so I am sure next time he will make less mistakes. So this is a cultural paradigm shift I am talking about. That, okay, in higher end innovation, we are going to fail. Many of us are going to fail. But that should not deter us from taking new challenges. So I was in pharma company and working on a drug discovery where the chances of success is less than 10%. When I started, because I started very early days, in the drug discovery, we used to give each new project a project number. So when I joined, it was project number 2. And when I stopped working in the pharma company, it was project number 26. So in 16, 17 years of my corporate life, I ran around 25 drug discovery projects. But actually, the number of projects working when I left was only 6. That means 20 odd projects I have killed. I myself have killed. I said, no, this is not working. Let us stop investing money in it. And it is to be a very painful process for youngster to tell that your project is not working and let us do something different. But if you explain them rationally, they will accept it. If you tell that it is nothing to do with you or failure on your behalf, it is the nature of the project that is responsible. Somehow jugaad karke project ko success hai aisa paper pe dikhana, ye jo apni aadat hai, that is actually the biggest killer of the innovation. So my friends, what I am trying to tell you is that if you want to be innovator, first of all, you need to challenge yourself. You need to challenge every concept, every idea, every notion, every lesson your professor teach you in your mind. Because nothing is permanent. Concepts do change. Ideas do change. And third most important is that don't be fearful of the failures. Failure is a part of the life. Failure is a part of the great innovation. You know Steve Jobs, all of you should read the biography of Steve Jobs. He started Apple Computers. He was thrown out at some stage because Apple Computers was not going anywhere. When he was thrown out, then others have realized that then they have nothing to do. So he was brought back. And then he went on launching for iPod, then iPad, then MacBooks, etc. And creating a very niche space for himself. So this is something which always we should be aware about. That one failure doesn't matter. There is always things to learn from it. Now coming back to the larger ecosystem. And in last 5 years, the government of India has taken several initiatives to nurture this ecosystem. And this is a positive side I want to tell you. First of all, there were several regulatory hurdles for the startups and innovation. I'll tell you a very classic case. Coincidentally, he happened to be my friend. There was a guy called Arjun Surya and his friend Manish Tandon. They were working in the biological service industry in Calcutta. Both of them, one day they thought that, okay, enough of doing service for others. Let us do something on our own. So they came out of that company. They had a lot of savings. So they put all that money into it. Sold their apartments, went into the rental house, and started a company to develop a new drug in cancer. Very risky project. So, but they had determination, they also found some investors. So they have brought to a stage where they started talking to the big pharma companies, whether they can have some collaboration, or in commercial terms it is called as a licensing out agreement, where they will license out their technology to the company. So 2-3 big pharma companies, they told them that okay, you have done so far, it's good, you just do it one step more. and then we are willing to seriously license in this technology. So they had, the budget was 5 crores and they had 6 months in hand, because there was also competition. Other companies were also working on a similar mechanism. So they went to the government agencies. No one was ready to fund 5 crores in such a short notice. Finally, they went into the grey market, got 5 crores at 1.5% interest per month. That means 18% per year. But they still took it. They were convinced that this will work. After 6 months, they succeeded. The technology was licensed out to Roche. The name of the company is Curagen, C-U-R-A-G-E-N. You can do a Google search on it. And Roche, which is a Swiss multinational company, gave them $35 million upfront as a check in their bank account. Very good time to celebrate. Next day, they got a letter from income tax department that, okay, you got 35 million. Very nice, pay 30 million capital gains tax. So the system was like that. When they wanted money to do some breakthrough innovation, there was no government mechanism, no government system to fund that. And when they got the money, the government was first to pick up 30% share out of it. So when Modi government realized this, they made one significant change. And the change is that if you develop a technology in India, if it is patented in India, you means Indian citizen. If it is patented in India, and if you license it out or if you commercialize it, the capital gains tax, which was 30% in past, will be only 10%. And there are so many such changes have been taken place. If you go to the website of Department of Industry and check the startup action plan, you will see a series of such changes, policy changes that have been implemented by this government. Not only for the innovators, but also for the funders. For example, there was a big controversy going on about the angel tax. That means the angel investors who put high risk money for the innovation, they were taxed at some haphazard rate based on some perceived value. But now all these doubts about angel tax has been clarified. Even government is highly subsidizing filing of the patents by Indian innovators. And one of the biggest initiative that Professor Srivastava mentioned while introducing me is Atal Innovation Mission, named after Atal Bihari Vajpayee, our ex-Prime Minister. This is a very innovative hub of innovation which is under Niti Aayog. Fortunately, I am a part of it, its board. So what we are trying to do in Atal Innovation Mission is to change the attitude of students, to challenge their mind right from the school age. For example, there are something called as tinkering labs, which we have established in 5,000 schools all over India. And in those tinkering labs, the schools have to just give one small room, that's all. And everything is brought by the mission people. And what they tinker with? They tinker with robotics. They tinker with 3D printers at a school age. So that will give them enormous broadening of the vision. Then at a incubator level, you have a startup, you want to incubate your ideas. There are two incubators here in BHU campus, one and the other is in IIT BHU campus. The BHU campus is funded by Atal Innovation Mission. And then there are 25 new incubators are also being funded by Atal Innovation Mission. Then we have thrown some grand challenges on the infrastructure, on the healthcare, on the water pollution, etc., where anyone, if he or she has a breakthrough ideas, the funding is no limit. He can get very good funding provided you pass certain milestones. We have also started a lot of initiatives to cater MSME sector, because they do what is called as frugal innovations. You know that you go to your cycle puncture wala and he is doing something which no one else is doing. And I have seen one video, you must have seen it on the social media, how someone is using his motorbike to crush the sugar cane and to get the juice out of it, rather than doing it manually or rather than doing it based on the electric motor, which is very expensive. So many frugal innovations, they took place in India every now and then. But there is no one to systematically understand this, analyze it and scale it up to a bigger level so that others also can use it with giving up due credit to the innovator. So we have started recently a fresh program specifically to do this, specifically to address this sector. So these are so many initiatives we are taking at our level. What is required is from the young minds like you to be innovative in ideas, to be innovative in implementing those ideas, and also when you think that those ideas are not workable, they are not your babies, you should have a detached attitude towards it and stop it and start working on a new idea. So if we work in this fashion, I am not saying the larger ecosystem is perfect. We have miles to go. If you go to Silicon Valley or Boston to understand what kind of innovation ecosystem means, we have miles to go. But slowly and steadily we are growing in that direction. So I am sure from this audience also, there will be some very good innovators who will do something not only for the country but also for the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks.